فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، وإن شرح في كتاب جلباب المرأة المسلمة في الكتاب والسنة written by الشيخ محمد ناصر الدين الألباني رحمه الله تعالى. We've previously taken two verses in the first condition, which is استيعاب جميع البدن إلا ما استثنيا, that the beauty of the woman, the outer garment which she wears in public must cover all of her body except the face and the hands, according to Shaykh Al-Albani rahimahullahu ta'ala. Shaykh Nasir, he pushed two evidences. He put the ayah in Surah Al-Nur and the ayah in Surah Al-Ahzab. And we also mentioned the statement of who? Al-Hafidh ibn Kathir rahimahullahu ta'ala. Shaykh Nasir followed that up with a hadith narrated by Bukhari and Muslim in hadith Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And the understanding of Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and what he understood from the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim. Then Shaykh Nasir rahimahullah, he said, قلت وهذا المعنى الذي ذكرنا في تفسير إلا ما ظهر منها هو المتبادر من سياق الآية وقد اختلفت أقوال السلف في تفسيرها فمن قائل إنها الثياب الظاهرة ومن قائل إنها الكحل والخاتم والسوار والوجه وغيرها من الأقوال التي رواه ابن جرير في تفسيره عن بعض الصحابة والتابعين ثم اختار هو أن المراد بهذا الاستثناء الوجه والكفان. So he mentions that the views of the scholars regarding إلا ما ظهر منها is two views. One view is the view that we said is Ibn Mas'ud and Hassan al-Basri and Muhammad ibn Sirin and Abu al-Jawza and Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, which is that what is meant by إلا ما ظهر منها is what? الرداء والثياب. It's meant by the clothes and the outer garment. And we said the other opinion of the scholars of tafsir is Abdullah ibn Abbas, ibn Umar, Ata ibn Abi Rabah, Ikrimah, Sa'id ibn Jubair, Abi Sha'tha, Dahak, and it's the view pushed and strengthened by Ibn Jarir al-Tabari and also his student al-Imam al-Baghawi rahimahullahu ta'ala. Here there's a waqfa that we need to do now. Before we go into the kalam of Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, there is a point that we have to stand over, and there is something that we all have to understand, and that is which of the two verses came down. The two verses that we just mentioned now, Surah Al-Nur, alaykum as-salam, and Surah Al-Ahzab, which of the two came down first? What is, according to the view which is strongest, is that Surah Al-Nur came down first, and Surah Al-Ahzab came down after. Sheikh Albani doesn't deny that. Which one came down first? Surah Al-Nur came down first, and Surah Ahzab came down later. So the early one is Surah Al-Nur, and the later one is what? Surah Al-Ahzab. So some of the Mufassirin, like Ibn Abbas and others, when they commented on Surah Al-Nur, and they said, إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا, it means الْكَفُّ وَالْوَجْهُ وَالْكَفَّانِ. Don't think to yourself that they're trying to say that the woman can show her two hands and she can show her face. Because that was the first hukum that came down regarding the hijab. There is another verse, Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah 59 that we mentioned, that Ibn Abbas, when he came to that ayah, what did he say? يا أيها النبي قل لأزواجك وبناتك ونساء المؤمنين يدنين عليهن من جلابيبهن ذلك أدنى أن يعرفن فلا يؤذين وكان الله غفورا رحيما. عبد الله بن عباس, he clearly said that what is meant by يدنين عليهن من جلابيبهن, he said it means um, He said, Ibn Abbas, أَمَرَ اللَّهُ نِسَاءَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ Allah commanded the believing women, إِذَا خَرَجْنَا مِنْ بُيُوتِهِنَّ that if they leave their houses في حاجة for a need, أَنْ يُغَطِّينَ وُجُوهَهُنَّ that they cover their faces, مِنْ فَوْقِ رُؤُوسِهِنَّ from high above, بِالْجَلَابِيبِ with the jilbab, وَيُبْدِينَ عَيْنًا وَاحِدًا and they only show one eye. We'll come to the view of the eye showing later, inshallah ta'ala. Ibn Jarir brought that statement. Ibn Abi Hatim brought that statement. And Abi Abi Talha and Ibn Abbas. And Ali ibn Abi Talha, he's from the people who narrated from Ibn Abbas and Sahifatin. He narrated it from him from a Sahifa. Are you with me, brothers? And it's something Imam Ahmed strengthened, and he took the riwayat of Ali ibn Abi Talha from Ibn Abbas, and so did Imam al-Bukhari. Rather, Ibn Abbas's tafsir through Ali ibn Abi Talha is the tafsir that Bukhari relies on in his Sahih. That's a side point. Are we together? The ayah is Surah Al-Ahzab. يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ is also a view, it's a statement Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said about it, that the woman has to cover her face. Aisha even explained it that way. What did Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, تَزْدُلُ الْمَرْأَةُ جِلْبَابَهَا that the woman would cover the jilbab مِنْ فَوْقِ رَأْسِهَا from high above her head وَوَجْهِهَا and her face. Sa'id ibn Mansur narrated in his Sunan بِسَنَدٍ صَحِيحٍ. So we have two Sahabas, Ibn Abbas and Aisha. From the Tabi'een we have Abi Abidat al-Salmani, Muhammad ibn Sirin and Ibn Awn. And there is no companion who differed with Ibn Abbas and Aisha regarding what is meant by يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ. No Sahaba differed with Aisha and no Sahaba differed with Ibn Abbas. So now this clears for us that even if we do agree إِلَّا مَا ظَهْرَ مِنْهَا and we, for the sake of argument we say that it means الْوَجْهُ هُوَ الْكَفَانِ then this ayah was at the early stages when the hijab was made obligatory. And that the second ruling that had come is the ayah in Surah Al-Ahzab. Even if we take إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا there are two opinions that stand. There's an easy way to reconcile between the two. That the ayah when it said إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا except her adornment which she should not show except that which shows without her intention. We will say that the beauty, the zina, إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا is talking about the zina, the beauty, the adornment of the woman. The adornment of the woman is two types. A zina which is baatina, a hidden zina. Are you with me? And that is in وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ that is talking about the zina al-batina, the hidden zina. She can't show that except to her maharim. Her hair is her hidden zina. That's the part of the ayah where it's talking about وَلَا يُبْدِينَ they should not show zinatahunna their beauty. This beauty here is referring to the inner beauty. Are we all together? And then after that Allah says إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا are we all together? So إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا here, what is it talking about? Her inner beauty. Good. The second type of zina is الزِّينَ الظَّاهِرَ according to the other view of scholars, which is that the beauty is that which is the outer beauty. The outer beauty that shows from the woman. If you look at the scholars of tafsir, like what we mentioned about Ibn Abbas and Abdullah ibn Umar and Ata ibn Abi Rabah and Ikrim and Sa'id ibn Jubayr and Abi Sha'tha and Dhahak and the qawl chosen by Ibn Jarir and Baghawi and others, the view seems to be that they're talking about the beauty which is apparent. They're talking about the beauty which is apparent, which she shows towards her maharim, not what she shows to the non-maharim. So Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he is saying إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا it means Al-Kafu wal-Wajhan, He's actually talking about what she should show her what? Her maharim, her brothers and her sisters. لأن the siyaq of the ayah shows that. Rather, there are some riwayat Ibn Abbas, clearly it shows that he's even talking about the maharim, like what Bayhaqi narrated here. Look what he said. Ibn Abbas, look what he said after he brought it. He said, "Azinatul Zahira, al-wajh wa kuhlul ayni." He says, "Azinatul Zahira, Abdullah ibn Abbas." Azinatul Zahira, al-wajh wa kuhlul ayni, wa khitabul kaff wal khatam. Fa'ada tudhiruhu fi baytiha liman dakhala 'alayha. Fi baytiha, in her house. And then he read the ayah, "Wala yubdina zinatuhu illa ma dhahara minha." Are you with me? And then he goes on to say, Ibn Abbas, "Fa'amma خلخالها ومعضدتها ونحرها وشعرها فلا تبديه إلا لزوجها." She should not show except to her husband. Her neck, her bracelets in her leg, all of that she should not show except to her husband. Bayhaqi narrated this from Ibn Abbas. So Ibn Abbas, when he says إلا ما ظهر منها, it means the hands and the arms. He's referring to what? Is referring to what? Showing it to her maharim. And in other riwayat added the extra things that he didn't mention here, إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا الْوَجْهُ وَالْكَفَانِ, which is the hair. He mentions in the riwayat Bayhaqi, the bracelets on the leg, which she can show to her maharams. He mentions that as well. Are you with me? So this is how to reconcile between the views of the view of the scholars. Also the issue of some of the scholars saying that, مثلاً, that Ibn Jarir al-Tabri, and Al-Albani is going to bring that soon, inshaAllah ta'ala, he's going to bring it. That Ibn Jarir al-Tabri is what? Ibn Jarir al-Tabri's view is that the wajh and the kafan, that illa ma dhahara minha, is referring to what? The two hands and the face. Again, Ibn Jarir al-Tabri, in the ayah that he's talking about, is which ayah? Ayah to Surah An-Nur. Why don't you look at what he said at the last verse that came down regarding the women's hijab, which is the ayah Surah Al-Hazab. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, Imam al-Baghawi, Ibn Taymiyyah and others, they say something different from that. They all agree on that the woman has to cover her face and her hands. Look what al-Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said. Look what he said, rahimahullahu ta'ala, in his tafsir. He said, لا يتشبهن بالإماء في لباسهن, that the woman who is free should not imitate the woman who is a slave in her dressing. إذا هن خرجن من بيوتهن, when they leave their houses, لحاجتهن, for something that they need. فكشفن شعورهن, and that they show their hair. ووجوههن, and then they show their faces. وَلَكِنْ لِيُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ, but rather they should cover their hair and their face with their jilbab. Which ayah is this? Surah Al-Hazab. Abu Bakr al-Jassas is the same, he's min a'immat al-mufassirin. He also says in Surah Al-Hazab, which is the latest surah, he says, فِي هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ دَلَالَةٌ, this ayah has a clear-cut evidence, على أن المرأة الشابة مأمورة بستر وجهها, that the woman who's a shab, she's young, she's obligatory on her to cover her faces, عن الأجانب, from the foreigners, وإظهار الستر والعفاف عند الخروج, and that she should come with hiddenness and she should be chaste when she leaves the house. That's many of the mufassirin. Abu Layth Nasr al-Samarqandi al-Hanafi, in his tafsir, he says the same. أبو عبد الله بن أبي زمنين الثعلبي الكياء الهراسي الزمخشري العز بن عبد السلام البيضاوي النسفي ابن الجزي السيوطي البقاعي أبو سعود, all of those scholars of tafsir, they all mention that in ayat surah al-Ahzab it's telling the woman to cover her face. Are we all together? So this is how to reconcile between the two. That the hijab, when it came down, nazala mutadarrijan. That the issue of hijab of women, when it first came down, it came down gradually. And that Suratul Ahzab and Suratul Nur are given different instructions. And so Imam Ibn Jarir At-Tabari, when he is at Suratul Nur, he's going to talk differently than when he speaks in Suratul Ahzab, because of the fact that the timing is different. Are we all together on that? This is a point that Sheikh Nasir is critiqued here, rahimahullahu, rahmatan wasi'a, that he didn't take that approach. ثم اختار, going back to the kitab, ثم اختار هو أن المراد بهذا الاستثناء الوجه والكفان فقال. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari's قول is what we're going to read now. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, who is he first of all? Who is Al-Ibn Ibn Jarir al-Tabari? Our Aada and our norms is that what we do is we try to study every individual. What we try to do is we try to learn each imam. So who is Ibn Jarir al-Tabari? The best kitab that's written on the biography of Ibn Jarir al-Tabari is a kitab compiled by Sheikh Ali Shibl, who's still alive, hafizahullah. He came and visited Birmingham. Ibn Jarir al-Tabariyyu. Okay, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, who is he? His name is Muhammad Ibn Jarir Ibn Yazid Ibn Kathir Ibn Ghalib. He's very well known as Al-Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tabari. Al-Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tabari. He was born 224 and he died 310. He's a Mufassir and a Mu'arrikh. He's a great scholar of tafsir and he's a historian, wafaqih. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari is also a faqih. He has his own madhab. Ibn Jarir has his own madhab. It's called madhab Jaririyu. He has his own madhab. Lakin indarasat madhabu. His madhab, it perished. It went. It didn't last. The reason is because, again, you need a what? Students to carry on your madhab. So his madhab went. His nickname, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari is what? His nickname is Imam al-Mufassirin. He's known as Imam al-Mufassirin. He was born in Tabaristan. He was born in Tabaristan. He traveled to Ray, Baghdad, Kufa, and Basra. He traveled to all of those lands. And he took from the ulama, he took the science of Imam Malik and the knowledge and the madhab of Imam Malik. He also took Ibn Wahbin, rahimahullah's knowledge. And he stayed in Baghdad for a portion of time. And he lived and he resided there. Khatib al-Baghdadi, rahimahullah, he said about him, كَانَ حَافِظًا لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari was a scholar who memorized the Book of Allah. عَارِفًا بِالْقِرَاءَةِ. He is a scholar who has great insight of qira'at. بَصِيرًا بِالْمَعَانِ. He has insight and the understanding and the meaning in the what? The Qur'an. فَقِيهًا فِي أَحْكَامِ الْقُرْآنِ. He is a faqih in the rulings of the Qur'an. عَلِيمًا بِالسُّنَنِ. He knew the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and he knew the turuq. He knew the narrations and its, he knew the riwayat. He knew صَحِيحِهَا وَسَقِيمِهَا. He knew those which were authentic and he knew those which were weak. He also knew نَاسِخَ and منسوخ, he said. He also said, عَارِفًا بِأَقْوَالِ الصَّحَابَةِ وَالتَّابِعِينَ. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he knew the statements of the Sahabas, and he knew the statements of the Tabi'in. وَمَنْ بَعَدَهُمْ and those who came after them, مِنَ الْخَالِفِينَ فِي الْأَحْكَامِ. Those who opposed them in ahkam. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari also knew, he said, Masail al-Halal wal-Haram. He knew what was halal and he knew what was haram. When he was a faqih, عَارِفًا بِأَيَّامِ النَّاسِ وَأَخْبَارِهِمْ. He said he also knew history. He also was deeply grounded in history. Ibn Jarir was a wara, a person who had excessive asceticism. عُرِضَ عَلَيْهِ الْقَضَى. They gave him a position to be a qadi. Now, a lot of the times you're going to read this in the ulama's taraji, in the biography of the ulama, that fulan عُرِضَ عَلَيْهِ الْقَضَى فَامْتَنَعَ. So-and-so was given qadha and he refused. What you really need to realize is that qadha was a high station, financially you were paid well off, and you had a powerful status, you were strong. The qadhi, you would have to do what he says. If the leader chose you to be in place, if he judges between two people, they have to take it. So it's a high position, it's extremely high, it's a political position today. So عُرِضَ عَلَيْهِ الْقَضَى. They gave him that position, فَامْتَنَعَ. He refused. He has many books, rahimahullah. He has many books. As Yaqut al-Hamawi said, وَجَنَّ فِي مِرَاثِهِ. We found from the things that we inherited from his works, مِنْ كُتُبِ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ 80 جُزْءًا. Over 80 volumes. All written on his hand, he said, بِخَطِّهِ الدَّقِيقِ. He wrote them all with his hand. He wrote اِخْتِلَافُ عُلَمَاءِ الْأَمْصَارِ. From the books that he wrote is books that talk about the khilaf of the ulama. And that was the first book Ibn Jalil al-Tabri wrote. The first book he wrote is اِخْتِلَافُ عُلَمَاءِ الْأَمْصَارِ, where he talks about the khilaf that occurred between the scholars. And he used to say, لِي كِتَابَانِ لَا يَسْتَغْنِي عَنْهُمَا فَقِيهِ. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari used to say, I have two books that a person who wants to be grounded in fiqh, who truly wants to be strong in fiqh, cannot be without. Al-Ikhtilaf and Wal-Latif. My book Al-Ikhtilaf and my Latif. He also authored a tafsir book, which he called it جَامِعُ بَيَانِ فِي تَأْوِيلِ الْقُرْآنِ, which is very well known as بتفسير الطبري. My car is blocking. Yeah? Hey, who's a good driver? Yeah? Abdul Ahad, huh? Yeah, Kale. Which is very well known as what? بتفسير ابن جرير الطبري. تفسير ابن جرير الطبري is known as. He has another book called Tariq al-Umam wal-Muluk. Tariq al-Umam wal-Muluk, where he talks about history, which is very well known as Tariq al-Tabari wa Tahdhib al-Athar. He has many other books. He has a book that he mentioned before, which is called Latif al-Qawl fi Ahkam Shara'i' al-Islam. He also has a kitab, Kitab al-Qira'at. He has another kitab which is called Sarih al-Sunnah, which is an Aqidah book. He has another kitab called At-Tabsiru fi Ma'alim al-Din. At-Tabsiru fi Ma'alim al-Din. And those two books, inshallah, we're going to go through, inshallah. Sarih al-Sunnah that he wrote, and his kitab At-Tabsiru fi Ma'alim al-Din. He died when it was the month Shawwal. The year was 310, and he was buried in Baghdad. He was buried in Baghdad. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. Ibn Jarir, one of the things that he was very well uniquely known for is al-nubuhu wal-dhaka. He was very smart and very clever. Allah gave it to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And his smartness and his brain was dhaka, which was khariq al-ada. It was out of the norms. It's out of the norms. Rahimahullah. His hafidah, his memory was nadir, unique. And that's what his father saw him at a very young age. When his father saw that his son was sharp in his memory and he was sharp in his learning, what did he do? He pushed him towards seeking knowledge. And he made him take classes. And Ibn Jarir al-Tabari was only 7 years of age when he memorized the Quran. وَصَلَّى بِالنَّاسِ. He was the imam who led the people. وَهُوَ ابْنُ ثَمَانِي سَنِينَ. He was 8 years old when he led the people. He was an imam who led the people at the age of 8. He wrote hadith books when he was 9 years of age. When he was 9, he was writing books of hadith. There's a story that's mentioned about his memory and his memorization. That al-Imam Abu al-Hassan al-Sirri ibn Mughallis, he said, Wallahi by Allah, inni la'adhunu, I think he said, Aba Ja'far al-Tabari, that Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, qad nasiya mimma hafidha ila an mat. Wallahi innani la'adhunu Aba Ja'far qad nasiya. He said, Wallahi by Allah, inni la'adhunu, I think Aba Ja'far al-Tabari, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, قد نسيه, he forgot, مما حفظ إلى أن مات ما حفظه فلان طول عمره. That Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he forgot, مما حفظ إلى أن مات, until he died, ما حفظ, in other words, what Ibn Jarir al-Tabari forgot. The knowledge which Ibn Jarir al-Tabari missed and he forgot is far less than what that person memorized. Ibn Jarir's memory. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari rahimahullah, as any individual would have, he would go through, he went through mihna. He was shown a lot of hardship, especially at his later stages in his life. He went through a lot of hardship, a lot of criticism, a lot of insult, a lot of pain was put through. And this was done to him by at-ta'assub al-madhhabi, people who had fanaticism in madhab. They were fanatic in madhab, they showed him a lot of enmity. And the heads of the people who did this to him were the Hanabila. The Hanabila, because they had a strong hold in Baghdad. That was their place. So when Ibn Jarir al-Tabari was in Baghdad, they showed him a lot of hate. They actually tried to kick him out of Baghdad. They even tried to kill him, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, rahimahullah. Ibn Jarir had many students that took knowledge from him. Ahmad ibn Kamil al-Qadi was from them, Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Shafi'i, Mukhallad ibn Ja'far, Ahmad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Husayn al-Jubhani, Ahmad ibn Musa ibn al-Abbas al-Tamimi, Abdullah ibn Ahmad al-Farghani, Abd al-Wahid ibn Umar ibn Muhammad Abu Tahir al-Baghdadi, and many others. Inshallah ta'ala, many scholars, they praised him. And Imam al-Nawawi said about him, أجمعت الأمة على أنه لم يصنف مثل الطبري. And Imam al-Nawawi, he said, it is a unanimous agreement that no one authored like Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. Khatib al-Baghdadi, what he said about him is that كان أحد أئمة العلماء يحكم بقوله ويرجع إلى رأيه لمعرفته وفضله. He said that he's from one of the ulama. His speech is made as a judgment. He's referred back to, his opinions are referred back to, because of his knowledge and his virtue. وكان قد جمع من العلوم ما لم يشارك في أحد من أهل عصره. He gathered sciences that no one participated with him in the knowledge of this from the scholars of his time. وكان حافظا لكتاب الله. We read that part before. أحمد بن كليخان, he said العالم المجتهد, العالم العصر, صاحب التصانيف البديعة. He said he's an alam, a scholar who is مجتهد, which درجة الاجتهاد. He was an alim, he said about him, of his time. Great authorship. Al-Badi'ah, his books are great and they are immense. كان ثقة صادقا, was a truthful, reliable individual. حافظا رأسا في التفسير, he was a head in tafsir. إماما في الفقه, he was an imam in fiqh. And he also was what? إماما في الفقه والإجماع والاختلاف. رحمه الله. Ibn Athir praised him, Dahabi praised him. Al-Qafati praised him, Ibn Khuzayma, who was a contemporary, who was his friend. Both of them were friends, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari and Ibn Khuzayma. He said, مَا أَعْلَمُ عَلَى أَرْضِي ما أعلم على الأرض أعلم من محمد بن جرير. But Ibn Khuzaym said, I don't know anyone on the face of this earth more knowledgeable than Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. Ibn Taymiyyah said about him, وَأَمَّا التَّفَاسِيرِ. As for the tafasir, التي في أيدي الناس, the tafasir that are present with the people today, the books of tafsir that we have today, فَأَصَحُّهَا, the most authentic one is tafsir Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari. The most authentic book of tafsir is the tafsir of Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari. فَإِنَّهُ يَذْكُرُ مَقَالَاتِ السَّلَفِ, because he mentions the statement of the Salaf, بِالْأَسَانِيدِ الثَّابِتَةِ, he mentioned them with chain of narrations which are affirmed. وَلَيْسَ فِيهِ بِدْعَةٍ, Ibn Jarir never had no innovation in him. وَلَا يَنْقُلُ عَلِي الْمُتَّهَمِينَ, and he will never narrate from those who are suspected. So Ahlul Bid'ah don't like Ibn Jarir al-Tabari because he doesn't share with them innovation, and he destroys them with bringing them the أقوال and the مقالات السلف, the statements of the سلف. السيوطي said about him, الإمام أبو جعفر رأس المفسرين على الإطلاق. السيوطي said about this. He said أبو جعفر ابن جرير الطبري, he is the head of the مفسرين unrestrictedly. أحد الأئمة, he's one of the imams, جمع من العلوم ما لم يشاركه فيه أحد من أهل عصره. He gathered knowledge and understanding of sciences, no one else shared it with him. No one else shared it with him. Ibn Kathir praised him. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah also praised him. And many other scholars, they praised his knowledge and his understanding. As I said to you before, a nice summarized book of Ibn Jarir al-Tabari's life, and that which we took it from is Ali Shibli's kitab that he wrote about Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. One thing you need to realize that Ibn Jarir initially, when he wrote his tafsir, he sat with his students and he said to them, I'm going to write a tafsir book. So they asked him, how many volumes is it going to be? And he said, it's going to be this much volumes. They said, who's going to read that? That's too much. So Ibn Jarir then said, okay, I will summarize it. And the tafsir that we have of him today, that's nearly how many volumes? 20 something? 30? That tafsir is a summary of what was Ibn Jarir's initial plan. He did the same when he wrote his kitab, Tariq al-Muluk wal-Umam. He sat with his students again, and he said to them, I'm going to write a history book, and I'm going to make it this much volumes. They said, that's too much. That's too much. So what they did was, he said, okay, I'm going to summarize it. Again, it's roughly the same volumes as well. It's a summary. ولذلك, scholars, they sat down to look at Ibn Jarir's life and the works that he's put together. And they realized from the day Ibn Jarir al-Tabri was born till the day he died, every day he wrote 40 pages. That's how the average, they scaled it out, his life, his writing. That it would be average, every day of his life, from the day he was born till the day he died, 40 pages that he wrote. 40 pages that he wrote every single day. We need this type of aspiration. People who read like that. Forget writing is harder than reading. Imagine what he has to read. Imagine the knowledge that he has to digest, the information that he needs to take in. We're talking about 40 pages every day. How many pages of the Quran do you read a day, let alone read a knowledge-based book? So these are the ulama and the people of knowledge. So Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, rahimahullah, he says, so we know who he is now, Ibn Jarir. And remember, brothers and sisters, knowing the statements of the ulama allows us to value their statements. When we study who they are, and we know a bit about them, now when somebody says to Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, said, okay, na'am, he has a right to say something, right? Or else you're going to think Ibn Jarir al-Tabari is, yeah, he's your next door neighbor. You won't value his statement. He won't mean anything to you. And also, when you learn a bit about the person, it's easier for you to memorize it. If you want to memorize statements sometimes from ulama, just maybe spend a couple of hours studying who they are. And I promise you, it will settle in your heart a lot of the times. Their quotes will settle with you in your heart. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said, وَأَوْلَى الْأَقْوَالِ فِي ذَلِكَ بِالصَّوَابِ قَوْلُ مَنْ قَالَ the strongest and the most accurate view is that which is that which says that the exclusion which is illa ma dhahra minha, that exclusion refers to ala bidhalika alwajh wal kaffayn, refers to the face and the lower part of the hands up to the wrist. يدخل في ذلك إذا كان كذلك الكحل والخاتم والسوار والخضاب. Also included are the kuhl, which is the face again, rings, bracelets, and makeup. وإنما قلنا, we have said, ذلك أولى الأقوال. We said that this is the strongest and most accurate view because all of the scholars are in unanimous agreement لإجماع الجميع على أن كل مصل أن يستر عورته في صلاته, that the scholars are unanimously in agreement that everyone who needs to pray must pray and must cover all their awrah in their prayer. على كل مصل أن يستر عورته في صلاته. So Ibn Jarir is now going to mention why he basically believes that this is the strongest and the most accurate view.